The Chicago Cubs, summer of 81, is brought to you by the following participating advertisers. Dave Kingman's bat and Rick Russell's arm were the focal points as the Cubs and Mets launched the 1981 season at Wrigley Field. It was the start of a bizarre year, which was to find the action off the field overshadowing the happenings on the field. The Cubs lost the opener 2-0, as these highlights and lowlights show, but 37,000 of their faithful hadn't seen anything yet. 3 days later, after having tied the Mets series at one apiece, the Cubs began a 12-game losing streak. The skid finally came to a halt on April 29th, when Mike Kruko shackled the Cardinals 6-1, just when it appeared the reversal never would end.
Fastball swung on. Let's put it away right here. Okay, Fletcher over to first. Double play. Dug out of the dirt. This ball game is all over. And here at Wrigley Field on April 29th, 1981, the ecstasy has replaced the agony for the Chicago Cubs, who have just ended the frustration of a 12-game losing streak by beating the Cardinals 6-1.
In May, Randy March beat Cincinnati 5-1 to interrupt another string of losses, reaching 8. General manager Bob Kennedy resigned the next day. Owner William Wrigley named Herman Franks as Kennedy's replacement.
It's been all the more frustrating because in so many of the games we have lost, we kept coming so close, only to be frustrated by one or two things that could have turned things around. With the possibility that I may be too close to the forest to see the trees, I've decided to bring in someone from the outside who is at the same time familiar with the organization.
Herman Franks had been on the job only 3 days when the Cubs staged one of the more memorable comebacks in the history of the franchise in a game against Pittsburgh. On June 6th, the Cubs drew over 30,000 for a Saturday date with the Dodgers, and they celebrated by pounding rookie sensation Fernando Valenzuela 11-5.
Well hit, deep to left by Crew. Back, 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 back. Looping liner over the head of the second baseman. And the throw, he put ahead a play at second base. As the young left-hander brings it to Jody Davis. Line drive, base hit, right field, 4-3 game. Lascano will take a token turn. Good thing he didn't challenge Guerrero there. Tyson switch hitting these days. And he drives one to left. Going. Runner going. Fly ball deep into right field. The ball is going to be up against the ivy. Jesus will come home. And Buckner will be into second with a double. There's a high pop down the right side. Garvey out. Right fielder in. The ball's going to be. It is dropping. Reach will score. Waller will come to third.
The Cubs completed a three-game sweep of the Giants on June 11th, but wouldn't you know, major league players went on strike the next day. 4 days later, another shocking announcement shook the baseball world. William Wrigley revealed he was selling the Cubs to the Tribune Company.
Maybe it's only a game, but baseball certainly has been in the headlines this month. Today's banner, the Cubs have been sold to the Tribune Company for $20.5 million, pending routine approval from the National League. Cubs broadcaster Jack Brickhouse and Milo Hamilton heard the news today just like everybody else, and I got their reaction.
In the case of the Chicago Tribune, they're now buying this, I'm sure, as an investment. And also, I have to think that the Tribune must have here the thought about, look, if this ball club is ever going to be sold, let's make sure that it's kept in Chicago by substantial people, and that's what we are. And from a personal standpoint, if the Chicago Cubs had to be sold, Bill, then I'm delighted that they're sold to the company that I work for and love.
This club has some things to do. It looks like a new source of revenue, and I think that's one of the reasons, if I read between the lines of what Mr. Wrigley said, that he felt that it was time somebody could take it over that had some wherewithal to put some money into the club, and evidently he didn't feel he did anymore.
Wrigley, who owns 81% of the Cubs stock, had this to say. For some time, I've been wrestling with the estate tax problems caused by the deaths of my parents. The release says, as well as with attempting to find a solution for the long-term financial needs of the Chicago Cubs. Wrigley added, the sale will transfer the club to a stable and a well-established entity committed to keeping the team in Chicago.
As for the strike, it lasted 50 days, the longest labor dispute in baseball history. The settlement came on July 31st.
Baseball's back on the headlines. We're going to play ball. The strike is an unfortunate interruption. Both sides are glad it's over. They signed an agreement that has something in it for both sides.
You don't total it up as victories or defeats. But I do think it has been a victory for the spirit of the players.
The National League approved the Cubs sale on August 6th. Tribune Company President Stanton Cook and Cubs Board Chairman Andy McKenna reacted.
We were very hopeful for a positive vote, and we got an 11-0 vote.
We tried to deal with this whole matter in a straightforward fashion from the very beginning, and we were confident, but we were also, as Andy said, we were very, very pleased when we had the affirmative vote from Chubb and the owners.
With peace restored on the baseball front, the Cubs and White Sox played a two-game city series. The first game resulted in a scoreless tie. The second went to the Cubs 4-3. That set the stage for a split season. It was just as well. The Cubs were sixth in the Eastern Division with a 15-37 record for the first half, and all smiles about the chance to start over again. The so-called second season got underway on August 10th, and the Cubs used the unique setup to experience some of their better moments of 1981.
The 0-1, a bouncer to second, bobbled, he goes through! Here comes Jody Davis, the Cubs have won it! How about the that could be two, one, and two, the ball in the dugout! It bounced back off the railing, we got a break. Baker scores, it's 4-4. Now they're going to claim interference at second, double play, game over. Ready again, runner going, 3-2, struck out, throw down, he's going to be out! A game-ending double play!
Hey.
Right down on the front end!
Oh, brother!
Here's the 1-2. Fly ball, left field. Dillard will tag. He's headed home. He is safe! The Cubs win! The Cubs have won it with a thrilling come-from-behind win over their most intense rival, the St. Louis Cardinals.
Doug Bird, obtained from the Yankees in a deal for Rick Rushel just as the strike commenced, shut out St. Louis 10-0 in September to trigger a three-game sweep which kept the Cubs in the race.
Looping pop out into shallow left center, dropping base hit. DeJesus will score handily, and it is 1-2-0. Oh. Bouncer up the middle. Buckner's going to make the turn. Cookie's going to wave him all the way. The throw toward the plate will be cut off. Bonds drives one. Way back. Going, going, and gone. Home run by Bobby Bonds. His second as a Cub. Two on and one out. Tabler the batter. Smash through the hole. Morales will be waved. They're going to check the arm of Orge. And it'll be safe.
He dropped the ball.
He dropped the ball.
Good.
There's
good.
A drive to left field. It is well hit. It is going. It is
gone.
A three-run homer by Bobby Bonds. Holy Toledo. Talk That's about a guy who's been struggling on a road trip. Almost barely able to buy a base hit, let alone RBI. And here he is today with two homers and five ribbies. It's 8-0. Martinez working with a one-run lead. There's a fly ball deep to right, going way back. The right fielder back, and it won't get it. It's gone.
Hey.
A home run over the right field fence by Durham. He has tied this game with one big swing. Line drive into left field. Bobby Bonds will race home. The throw toward the plate is going to be off target. Never know, something like that can do it. The Cubs went on to get three runs. There's a drive, way back into left field, going, going, and gone. A pavilion home run for Bobby Bonds.
Even as the second half progressed, the Cubs got hope for the future from such youngsters as Pat Tabler, Jody Davis, and Ty Waller.
For third. Buckner is headed for second. Headlong dive. And now they're going to, with that play going to second, good base running by the rookie Tabler. And it is 2-0. Bouncer off the glove of Evans. It's going to be safe everywhere. Bond steps on home plate. Davis safe at first.
Big hit. Deep. Back she goes. Back, back, back. Hey, hey! Another home run for Waller. Boy, three runs in for the Cubs.
There's a drive way back into center. Going, going, and gone. It's up on the hitting background and dead straight away center. Jody Davis has taken Orozco downtown. His fourth home run of the year. Fly ball deep to left center. That's pretty well back. It is off the vines out there. The wind prevented a grand slammer. Two runs are in. Here comes another one racing for the plate. And he scores. Henderson's across. Right behind Durham and Buckner. And the Cubs have three more runs.
The Cubs stayed in contention well into September before finishing fifth in the second half. Overall pitching honors went to Mike Kruko, who won nine games, including this 11 strikeout performance at San Francisco. The Cubs ringleader at bat once again was Bill Buckner. He hit 311 and went wild in the Cubs' home finale on Fan Appreciation Day.
There's a pretty well hit ball, deep to right, back, back, back. Again, hi, hi, another home run for Billy Buck. Oh, brother. There's a line shot, left center by Buckner. He's going to go after another double here, and it takes a bounce away from Lonnie Smith. And Buckner winds up on second, two more runs in for the Chicago Cubs.
Here is Buckner, and he'll get another hand. He's had about three standing ovations here today. Here's another one. Buckner homered in the third. Nobody on, one down.
High fly ball, right field, going, gone!
Holy Toledo, what a series for Bill Buckner. He is hotter than a depot stove. Nothing. Give me a high five, says the bull. And another standing ovation for Buckner. Hits it off of a left-hander. Well, he did just what I wanted him to do. He got us off at 13.
Hardly had the smoke cleared on the regular season when the Cubs revealed a new general manager at a Tribune Tower press conference.
We thought the job in keeping the purchase of the Cubs was done very effectively and very secretively. You, the press, have done a very good job of digging this story out. So I want to introduce to you now someone who at this point is no stranger to you, our new executive vice president and general manager, Dallas Green.
I see so many similarities between the 72 Phillies and the 1982 Chicago Cubs. It's intriguing. It's exciting. And I'm looking forward to it. If I didn't feel that we couldn't get the job done, I wouldn't be here today.
Mr. Manning.
One week later, this man, Lee Elia, was named to succeed Joe Amalfitano as field manager, thus climaxing a turbulent summer of 81. Chicago Cubs, summer of 81, brought to you by the following participating advertisers.
The great game of baseball has survived war, depression, recession, inflation, and all sorts of other adversities, and yet it's become nothing but stronger every year it goes by, all of which is a tribute to this great game and the very marvelous, marvelous hold it has on the sporting public. It's been such a pleasure to be a part of that game. I think there's a line in Bob Hope's theme song that describes not only baseball, but also our business very well, Milo, our broadcasting business. And the line reads, "You may have been a headache, but you never were a bore. Thanks for the memories."
The Chicago Bulls battle the New York Knicks next. For the best in sports, turn to Channel 9, America's number one sports station.